All right, so welcome everybody to our first seminar of the year. It's a pleasure to start with a friend, in this case, Javi Molina from the Universidad de Cartagena. He is going to tell us about entanglement, holography, and tensor networks. So please, Javi.
Okay.
Yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Pepe, for considering your friend, even. So I'm glad to give you this seminar. So thank you for inviting me. And yeah, as the title of the seminar says, entanglement, holography, and tensor networks. Well, the topics of the, especially the first part of the talk, in which I will make the first part mentioning or considering the intersection of different this intersection areas between different parts of physics, right? That basically talks about the entanglement as an excuse to talking about tensor networks and holography, especially ADS-CFT, the connection between them. So I will try to make an introduction, so some comments. Probably I will leave in important parts. I will try to explain myself properly, and then in the second part I will try to show some recent developments made in collaboration with José Juan Fernández Melgarejo and Emilio Torrente Luján at the University of Murcia, trying to justify which some advances and trying to show you that these are necessary advances in order to advance in the problem of connecting or giving or having insights in the connection between tensor networks and holography. So let me start saying that the holographic principle has provided us with the ADS-CFT, that is a truly non-perturbative formulation of quantum gravity in negatively curved spacetimes in terms of quantum field theories. Yet this is as far as only to talk about specifically about this is that this duality talks about that the equivalence or duality between the partition function, the generating functional of a gravitational theory living in a d plus two dimensional manifold, with the partition function of a quantum field theory or quantum many body system living in the boundary of this manifold, d plus one dimensional boundary. We have some entries in the dictionary defining this duality. We have also grammatics, but still we would like to know how holography works in other spacetimes, for instance spacetimes with interest in cosmology, for instance the sidereal spacetimes, etc. So it's clear that we need to better understand how holography works. The claim of nowadays, the claim for many researchers, relevant researchers, is that quantum entanglement could be a key concept to understand holography. So this is not surprising because if you look at the structure of these dualities between gravitational theories and boundary conform quantum field theories. Let me consider that the basic object living in this boundary theory is the state of the system. It's a quantum state of the quantum field theory, for instance, the ground state, etc. So even symbolically, holography makes that equivalence or says that this basic object and the basic object in the gravitational theory, the structure of space-time, should be encoded, at least the quantum state should be encoding this structure. So one of the main quantum mechanics tell us that the one of the properties, surprising properties of quantum mechanics is the entanglement of the state. So this is some philosophical grounds why many people think that quantum entanglement, the study of the structure of entanglement of these states, could be a concept, basic concept to better understand holography.
Sorry, Javier, do you mind if I ask? This is a very naive question. I'm Juan García Villedo. So Juan. I'm curious about this connection. The question is, why do you say you have quantum gravity in the bulk I thought you had classical gravity in the bulk.
Well, I mean the equivalence between the partition functions is at any level of I mean the idea CFT is a duality, is a strong weak connection, right? So what is known is that as far as these theories in the boundary are very strongly coupled, especially we have a large number of fields and strongly coupled here. The theory collapsed to a semi-classical description of gravity, right. but the proposal is that this is a complete equality. So weakly coupled field theories here should have a very complicated quantum gravitational description in the bulk. This is as far.
So you go to the other side and you say, okay, weak quantum field theories would then have a description as a quantum gravity strong in the strong regime where you have non-perturbative effects.
Exactly.
Has that connection been done already? So do you have effects that you can qualify as quantum gravity effects from this connection?
Has that been explored already? I don't know of explicit examples. I remember some papers by Alex Maloney talking about the gravity duals of the icing model or something like that, quantum icing model that is not. What is expected to work in holography, that is a central charge very, very equal to 1/2. So, but I mean, I don't know. It's not exactly my field. I don't know if there are some explicit results on working with a quantum gravitational theory or having a hint of what is the quantum gravitational theory.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. So in this talk, I'm going to focus on the efficient descriptions of this wave function. I will be changing wave function at wave functionals because at the end I want to talk about field theories, but we are going to focus on efficient descriptions of this wave function that describe the boundary quantum many body system on quantum field theory. Right? So efficient is important because it's an excuse to introduce the concept of tensor networks. Right? So what are tensor networks? Tensor networks are efficient variational descriptions, and this is important, efficient and variational descriptions of the wave functional based on the entanglement structure of the state. So this is the thing is that we are going to analyze these wave functionals, these wave functionals in terms of entanglement. In some sense, we are going to order, we're going to schematize, or we are going to systematize the structure of entanglement in these wave functions. And this provides us with efficient descriptions of these objects, right? I will say more in a few slides about this, but by construction, these states. So, I mean, tensor networks are descriptions, are efficient descriptions or the wave function, the wave function of the theory, right? So by construction, they fulfill the area law of entanglement entropy. I will exemplify this later, right? So this is the reason because these descriptions lie in a small corner of Hilbert space. So the thing is that imagine that you have a full Hilbert space of full Hilbert space to describe your, for instance, the ground state of your theory. There are a small corner of the Hilbert space in which lies the states which fulfill the area law of entanglement. I will mention. Basically, the explanation is the following: if you take a region of a region of your theory, a spatial region of your theory, then you want to compute what is the entanglement between this region and the rest of the system, area law means that the entanglement scales with the area of the region that you are considering and not the volume, right? Tensor networks are by construction fulfill the area law of entanglement, and the efficient descriptions of these area law states are what in which tensor network focus. So it's a very small region of the full Hilbert space, right? So Let me explain with an example what is the basic idea behind these tensor networks. Let us consider a very simple state in the lattice of a chain of n spins, for instance, 1/2 spins, is one which is local Hilbert spaces. And this is the wave function describing our quantum many-body system, right? Basically, this is what the people in quantum information call in the computational basis, in the physical sides of the state. So in order to know what is this wave function, we need to we need to define which are these coefficients, right? So if this is one half spins, we can consider these coefficients as a tensor with these physical entries. So we need to determine 2 to the n coefficients. It's a highly inefficient. We need to know many things to determine this very complex wave function, right? So the idea of a tensor network that is inspired by developments in the DMRG in the 90s, etc., is the following. So we're going to, let me do the following. I'm going to make a Schmidt decomposition between this guy, G1, and the rest of the system, right? I'm going to make this Schmidt decomposition. So imagine that I'm going to make the composition in which I have this thing, describing this local thing, this local tensor, describing G1. And imagine that this is the rest of the system, is a blob. So this leg represented the contraction, right? The contraction represents the Schmidt decomposition between G1 and the rest of the system. So what we're going to do is to do this in a way of a succession, right? Now we're going to compute what is the Schmidt decomposition between these two guys, G1, G2, these two guys, and the rest of the system, right? So now we are computing what is the entanglement. So the Schmidt decomposition accounts, or the rank of the Schmidt decomposition accounts for the what is the entanglement between these two guys and the rest of the system. So I can do this in a successive way, and at the end I can construct this make something like a succession of singular value decomposition or Schmidt decompositions, in which each one of these internal legs accounts for the Schmidt rank of the decomposition. So each one of these legs represent what is the entanglement between, for instance, this leg here in magenta, represent what is the entanglement between these two guys and the rest of the system, right? And something we can do is the following. We can try to introduce some parameter called chi. It is a bond called bond index that is something like a cutoff in the Schmidt decomposition. It's something like in each Schmidt decomposition, local Schmidt decomposition, I'm going to keep chi eigenvalues, and I throw away all the rest of the eigenvalues, right? So in doing this, in some sense, I'm cutting off the Schmidt decomposition. So I'm keeping a fixed number, chi of these eigenvalues. So at the end, it can be proved that you can represent this big tensor with the big number of entries in terms of this decomposed tensor, but the number of coefficients that you have to find, for instance, in a variational optimization problem, minimizing the energy, is of this order. So it's quite more efficient. This number is quite more lower than this one, right? So of course, by fixing chi, what you are doing is basically increasing chi. What you are exploring is more and more increasing the space in which you are approaching the true, for instance, the ground state of the system, right? So of course, chi equal one, for those of you that know what is a Schmidt decomposition is basically a mean field state. It's a product state, right? It's in a state with no entanglement. Right, but this is the idea of a tensor network. Yes, I want to emphasize something that is for the sake of the following, is that each one of this bond represents or supports or have to take into account how much entanglement there is between this part of the system and the other part of the system. So of course, you can imagine that these representations are going to work properly by fixing one, once you fix chi, they are going to work properly if there is a short range entanglement in your system. Because if you fix chi, you have to take into account all the entanglement between these guys and the rest of the system. So what happens when there is a long range entanglement? When there is long range entanglement, you have to take into account all the entanglement between all this part of the system and the other one. So you have to increase much more chi. So immediately your description of this tensor is more inefficient. Well, this is the basic idea, and what I'm describing is something called in the area of tensor networks called matrix product state. Well, so the idea is that tensors are local tensors are local building blocks for the quantum state represented by this big piece, and by making contractions and singular value decompositions, you can make these small pieces, and contracting them, you can approximate this quantum state. Well, so let me mention the idea of the area law by construction. The idea is the following. If you grasp the idea of what it means that is a local bond, a local this local bonds, imagine that you want to have this spin chain, or you have this theory in the lattice, and then you're interested in computing what is the entanglement between this left part and this right part. Okay, so the thing is that you are going to, by definition, you have to look at the bond that is take into account what is the entanglement between this part and this part, and compute the log of the Smith rank, right? Okay, so now imagine that you are interested in this block of spins. Now you have to take into account how many of these bonds you have to cut in order to isolate this region of interest with the rest of the system. In this case, you multiply the log of the Smith rank by 2. This is an upper bound. This is an upper bound for the entropy, but for optimized tensor networks, this upper bound, the entropy approach this upper bound. Well, in two dimensions, we have a system with 2 dimensions. There are a class of tensor networks for two-dimensional systems called projected entangled pair states. The idea is that imagine that you are interested in this region, the inner region, and this is the outer region. And then you ask, what is the entanglement entropy, or at least the upper bound for entanglement entropy for this inner region? Then you have to count the number of bonds accounting for the entanglement between inner guys and outer guys, multiplied by the log of the Smith rank by the number of bonds that you have to cut. So in this case, 4L. Of course, when you go for higher dimensions, the idea of area law takes sense, because if you go to 3 dimensions, what you will see is that the entanglement in these states scales with the boundary of the region that you are interested in, not with the volume, only with the perimeter. This is the violation of the area law with these two guys, and in 3 dimensions with the area, etc. This is the origin of the term area law. So, yeah, this is the basics of tensor networks. This by construction are approximations for instance, the true ground state. You have some variational parameters that are the tensors. This and the structure of the tensors are defined by chi, and fulfill the area law of entanglement. Right. So some comments in relation with I have mentioned is that chi captures Well, this is not exactly true. Chi captures the entanglement between this region and the other region. So for gap system, this chi, in order to have a proper approximation to your gap system, chi should be proportional with some scaling law, polynomial scaling law, with a correlation length. But, and here is the problem, what happens for systems in a second order phase transition, or critical systems, or even when systems, we have systems with a lot of very long range correlations, right? So this means that if you are trying to describe a system with very long correlations or entanglement, there is the structure of entanglement have a long distance entanglement, you require larger and larger chi. So immediately your description is quite inefficient, and especially is inefficient at the critical point, right? So originally these systems were devised to study systems in condensed matter and many body physics, so the interest in critical systems is obvious. So the thing is that how could we solve this problem? So normally in physics or in many areas of physics, we're interested in long range physics, in physics at long distances. For instance, the 2-point correlators in long distance in field theories tell us much about the excitation structure of the theory. So the thing is that we would like to have these efficient descriptions with a low chi as possible. But now, if you are interested in long-range physics, first of all, we need to make some kind of coarse graining. So we need a procedure, something like an RG procedure for going to long-range physics. But the descriptions in long-range physics with these tensor networks are inefficient because we have to take into account we're weighted down by the short-range entanglement. So basically, if we are interested in the long-range entanglement in these tensor networks, these guys are completely done having to take into account the short-range entanglement. So the idea is, how could I have efficient descriptions for entanglement at different length scales, at different scales, without the problem of having to take into account for at each length scale, having to take into account the short-range entanglement? Well, the solution for this problem was given by Giffre Vidal in 2007 with the multi-scale entanglement renormalization ansatz called MERA. Well, the idea is the following. The idea is the first thing is that we want to coarse grain. We want to coarse grain. So we need to have a procedure for going for short range on the lattice for going for long distances. We have to coarse grain our sites. So in order to do this, we're going to introduce something called isometries that are tensors that must be optimized, of course, by an energy minimization procedure, optimize and take two sides, for instance, take two sides and coarse grain into one side. So then it's a projection to a zero state, but it's basically passing from a representation of two sides into two one. But before doing this, what we are going to do is to apply a kind of tensors called disentanglers that are unitarities that remove the short range entanglement between these two guys. So the idea is the following. So you have your original lattice site, you disentangle neighboring sites, and then when you have disentangled these sites, then you coarse grain. Now, as a result, what you have is a new representation of your lattice system at longer distances, coarse grain version, but now you are able to, with a fixed chi, you are able to have an efficient representation of the entanglement, as you have here before, of entanglement at these distances, not increasing chi, because you have removed the short range entanglement. So you have not to weigh down the bonds every time because you have removed the short range entanglement. So it's an efficient way of going at long distances, studying or having proper representation of the entanglement structure of the wave function at different length scales with some efficiency. Immediately, this structure, make sure that this you call X space, that is the real space, immediately appears the sense that you have some new direction in your tensor network, that this U is called U, is the scale, is labeling the scale at which you are doing you are taking your procedure, right? You are studying your system. Well, this is the idea of MERA. I'm going to repeat what I said, is that imagine that you have a system with L sites, and then here is your original system. Here, entangled locally, it should be disentangled locally. Well, the idea is that now we disentangle these neighboring sites. And we coarse grain, right? We coarse grain, and now we have L over 2. We have a new representation at different length scale, a longer different length scale of our system. Now we can repeat this procedure. We can repeat this procedure, and now we can disentangle these coarse grain sites and coarse grain again. We have a new representation at different length scale of our system, in which we only take care or take into account the entanglement between the big regions that we are where we have coarse grain. Now we are representing the entanglement of between bigger regions. Right? We can repeat this again, coarse grain, and at the end of the day, after if our system is finite, we arrive at the finite tensor, top tensor for finite system, in which represents is a representation of a wave function that is completely disentangled, it's completely factorized. That is, we have removed all the entanglement at all length scales. Of course, something important I need to say here. What happens with L if L is infinite? If L is infinite and the system is critical, you will arrive to this top tensor after an infinite number of coarse grainings. And if your system is gapped, even if your system is finite, there is a moment in which the entanglement, the correlations, vanish for longer distances than the mass gap, the inverse of the mass gap. So you will arrive at the finite number of steps, you will arrive at this top tensor. Well, okay. So now, let me. I have mentioned the area law of entanglement for the tensor network construction. What happens to MERA? What happens in MERA? Imagine that you have this tensor network, this representation. You have put you have optimized your tensor network. And then you are interested in the entanglement between the entanglement of this block of spins, this L block of spins, right? So the thing is that now you have a representation in which are the value of the correlations or the structure of the correlations at different length scales. So the idea is that you have to isolate this region. You have to isolate or count the number of bonds that isolate this original region from the rest of the tensor network. Now the tensor network is a full description of your wave function at different length scales. So the idea is that in order to isolate or to count the number of bonds with the wave of the Schmidt, the log of the Schmidt decomposition, you have to cut to trace something like this kind of geodesic curve in the bulk. I am introducing, by of course, this is a trick. This is a oratory trick. In the bulk of the tensor network, you have to cut this number of bonds that joining these bonds should be something like a geodesic curve, right? Because why? Because you are isolating what is the measuring what is the entanglement, this short range entanglement, long distance entanglement, etc. Right? You have to isolate this in a sequence of different length scales. So the idea is that interestingly, you is exactly the same area law. You multiply the upper bound for this entanglement is the log of this Schmidt decomposition and the length of this curve. But now, no, it's not a perimeter or something. It's a perimeter of a bulk region in the tensor network. It's a perimeter of this region. It's not a physical perimeter. It's a perimeter in the direction of renormalization. And interestingly, this thing is approximately goes like log L. So immediately we recover the violation of the area law, the saturation of the area law for critical systems in one dimension. So the MERA was devised in order to accomplish for this, to be able to compute entanglement entropy of, to give account for the entanglement entropy in these one dimensional systems, etc. Right? So looking at this, it's tempting to, somebody could be tempted to remember what is the way of computing entanglement entropy in ADS-CFT. We have the famous Ryu-Takayanagi formula in 2006 that tells us the following. Now I'm talking about ADS-CFT. Imagine that you have a conformal field theory that lives in a D plus one dimensions, and you're interested in computing the entanglement entropy of this region with the rest of the system. If this theory has an holographic dual given by an asymptotically ADS spacetime, so The Ryu-Takayanagi formula tells us the following. So the thing is that you have to compute a surface gamma A that connects in the boundary of the quantum field theory with the boundary of this region A, gets deep into the bulk of anti-de-Sitter space, and you have to compute this area and then minimize this surface. Right, the area of the, you have to minimize the area of the surface. So introducing this computation, this geometric computation here, immediately gives you the leading contributions of the entanglement entropy. There are some quantum corrections, and the quantum corrections can be computed by different means, computing entanglement between the bulk fields here inside. But I do not enter here. But this is the leading contribution to the entanglement entropy given by Ryu-Takayanagi. So it was tempting for some people to looking at the structure of the Ryu-Takayanagi formula, how it computes the entanglement entropy, and looking at the structure of entanglement given by MERA tensor networks. Brian Swingle in 2009 proposed that MERA could happen to be a realization of the ADS-CFT. In which the entanglement structure of the wave function, or the wave functional, was encoded in terms of a discrete higher dimensional geometry that is a discrete version, that basically is a discrete version of anti-de-Sitter space. This was the proposal by Swingle. It's highly inspiring, and it propelled a lot of research in this direction. Yeah, the thing is that as far as the Ryu-Takayanagi formula is a machine that in which you enter geometric information and gives you entanglement. MERA tensor networks are something like, if you know what are the tensor properties and the connectivity of these tensors, you obtain the entanglement structure, right? So, of course, immediately there was the idea of that if there is a connection or there is something called a duality, a connection or whatever, in between ADS tensor networks, ADS MERA, or something like that, in which, and this should be what should be clearly stated, that geometric structures should be completely determined by the tensor properties and the connectivity of the tensor network, right? So, of course, and this is my this is a personal point of view. The work must be done in the sense that it should be important to have quantities that could be computed in a tensor network, could be computed as far as possible analytically or as far as analytical as possible, in which would be clear what is the connection or how the geometric structures or quantities that could be related with geometric structures in holography are sensitive to the tensor properties, right? So, and something very important from my point of view is that the tenet of holography is that you have to deal with large n number of fields and strong coupling. So, in this discrete versions, instead of being very inspiring or something like that, but it's very difficult to see what could be the role of large chain and strong coupling, right? Especially because MERA was devised as a tool in which you want a theory and you put here and this is the structure, it's fixed, right? So there is no sense of connection or direct connection between how the connectivity or the properties of the tensors are related with holographic descriptions. So yes, this is the point. This is the as far as my a very personal briefing about this connection between tensor networks and holography. This last thing is our main objective in our research, is that which are the features of large chain and strong coupling in MERA. Well, the thing is that it is believed that in order to advance in this program, probably is better to go for continuous versions of the MERA tensor networks. So for versions who deal with continuous theories, with quantum field theories. And this is the The proposal called CIMIRA, for continuous multiscale entanglement renormalization ansatz. This proposal was given by Jutta Hagemann, Verstrate, Osborne, and I don't know, in 2011. Was given in terms of incomplete analogy for the discrete version, right? This is the MERA circuit for a lattice system. Let me introduce something in reverse. Introduce something that I haven't said before, is that the MERA circuit could be seen in the following way. Imagine we're going to describe the MERA circuit in the following way. Imagine that you have you start with a very simple reference state, this completely disentangled and progress state, very simple, and now you proceed in reverse. Now, what you are going to do is to use these tensors, isometries, to expand the system and then create with disentanglers, now called entanglers, to create entanglement at long distances. Now you expand the system and create entanglement at shorter distances. Now you expand the system and then you create entanglement at very short distances until you arrive at the state. That is the definition of your state at the lattice spacing. So this can be described as some kind of Hamiltonian evolution. This can be this procedure here can be seen as something like a Hamiltonian evolution in a scale, not in time, in a scale U. Well, in complete analogy to this point of view for a discrete MERA, the continuous version of MERA was proposed in the following way. You start with a capital omega is in a Gaussian completely disentangled state here, and then you apply a Hamiltonian evolution in a scale until you arrive to the ground state of your system at some momentum cutoff that is resembles the lattice spacing here. This Hamiltonian evolution is given in terms of two operators. One is K, called entangler operator, that depends on you. All the variational parameters are inside this operator, and here is L, is a dilatation operator. So basically, the entangler operator resembles the disentanglers here, and the dilatations are the coarse grainers, right? By definition, the people who propose CIMIRA put it this is only language, that this state lies at U equal minus infinity, right? And when you arrive at this state, U, the scale U is given by zero, right? And the terminology is that this guy is the infrared state and this guy is the ultraviolet state. But this is completely terminology, right? This has nothing to do with something else. It's pure terminology. Well, here are some descriptions. So as far as we have here a sequence of scale-dependent wave functions, here we are going to have a sequence of scale-dependent wave functionals. Right? The similar wave functional is this projection of this state psi u on the configuration, on the field configuration of your theory. For instance, I'm going to talk about the n-scalar field theory, and in which we have this original state, and then we apply this Hamiltonian evolution in a scale, right? With this operator, the entangler operator and the cos and the dilatation operator. Well, the entangler operators is the only variational parameters of the ansatz are those which parameterize this, right? Well, this is the idea of CIMIRA, and I'm going to say something. What we know about CIMIRA. So the idea was, okay, let's do something with this and let's try to see how this program works. And the thing is that the first examples and the only well-known, I would like to say up to now, is are the theories that are free theories. Not free theories, free boson, free fermions. I'm going to talk about for the moment for free bosons. The reason is the following, is because, you know, if you start here with a very simple reference state that is a Gaussian, it's very easy. It's very easy for many reasons to create unitary evolutions in a scale that transform a Gaussian state into a Gaussian state. And this is accomplished in terms of quadratic entanglers. Quadratic entanglers are these operators in which you only use these quadratic operators, phi squared, p squared, and p phi, phi p, right? Well, the thing is that this is the solution. This is where the examples work it out for Semira, the free boson theory. The solution proposed for the free boson theory is that alpha 1 and alpha 2 is 0, and these two guys, alpha 3, alpha 4, are equal and are given by this function GKU. GKU is the variational parameter. It's a variational parameter. We use this this quadratic operator, right? And this variational parameter is decomposed into two things. One, a scalar function, KU, that is, I tell you, represents is something like should be a local in a scale, a local chi, a local chi is an analogous for the chi in the discrete version of MERA. And here we have some gamma functions. That these gamma functions are given in terms of the step Heaviside functions that are functions that limits the momentum intervals that we have in this definition of the operator. Of course, you can say that you can see that if you put these fields in the basis of creation and annihilation operators, this immediately leads you can write this entangled operator as a squeeze operator, right? So what you are going to generate if you put this you introduce this operator into this formula. You are going to create is something like a sequence of a scale-dependent squeeze current states, SU11 for the free boson theory. And of course, being a squeeze current state, the Gaussian Semira wave function, I say Gaussian here because this is a quadratic operator, and the states that you create at each length scale is a Gaussian wave functional. The Gaussian wave functional can be written. For those of you that know that what the Gaussian variational approximation, you create this kind of wave functionals with a kernel that is in a scale dependent kernel, and this kernel can be related or is defined in terms of the variational parameters of your theory, right? Well, this is of course we are doing a Hamiltonian evolution of a state in a scale, so this is basically quantum field theory in the Schrödinger picture. So if you are interested in looking at what is happening in terms of operators, if you take the canonical operator of your theory and you apply this transformation, this evolution in a scale, what you are doing is basically a linear and a scale-dependent transformation of the fields. Here in orange is that the influence of the influence on the transformation of the entangler. And here is the terms induced by the dilatation operator. If you write these things in terms of creation annihilation operators, what you will see is that basically what you are doing is something like a scale dependent Bogoliubov transformation, right? So we are each of these wave functionals is the displaced or is the squeeze vacuum for this new creation annihilation operator that are scale dependent, right? So it's a linear transformation of the fields. This is for the free theory, right? And now what about the optimization? The optimization is as any variational problem is about you compute the energy density of energy expectation value of your Hamiltonian. And then applying the definition of Semira, you write this thing in terms of variational parameters, and derive respect to the variational parameters equaling to zero, and you obtain these variational parameters, right? That depends on the scale. This strength of this entangler is given by this solution. Well, it's interesting that in the CFT limit, in the massless free boson theory, this is a constant, 1/2. So resembling that you have a scale invariance, you cannot see a difference at any scale. And when you have a massive theory close to the UV, so the energy or the energy is very high with respect to the mass gap. So basically, we are basically in the conformal limit at the moment in which you arrive at close to the mass gap. Immediately, the density of these entanglers is zero. This means that you have at that length scales you have arrived at the completely disentangled state due to the mass gap. Right? This was given by Hagemann, etc. Well, I'm a bit slow. So the question is that it is useful. How can we use now the continuous version for this proposal of being connected with holography? The thing is that in 2012, Nosaki, Ryu-Takayanagi studied the Fisher information metric, right? It's because, you know, it's basically you have a bunch of coherent states defined by a parameter u, and it's interesting to compute this Fisher information metric in terms of the fidelity susceptibility. What they found is that the Fisher information metric is given by gu squared, in which gu is chi u. Sorry for the change of notation, but this is because in the following we will have a mess of chi's, so I decided to change by a u. The Fisher metric measures the density of strings of disentanglers. The thing is that it's not possible to connect this immediately with a geometry or something like that, despite if you introduce this into this Fisher metric and takes into account the spatial part of this metric, you obtain hyperbolic spaces. You obtain the Euclidean version of anti-de-Sitter. But I mean, it's misleading to interpret this as a geometry of a space-time or something like that. Now, at this moment, the most promising connection of this quantity, the Fisher metric in Semira with holography, is with holographic complexity. I'm not going to enter into the definition of holographic complexity or what it is, but the thing is that there is, from the point of view of holography, complexity is a new quantity that could be interesting because it's a quantity that uses the volume of these spatial slices in this ABS sparse black hole, or the area of this Wheeler-DeWitt patch, etc., that are able to see the interior of the black hole. Right, so this is one of the reasons for being interested in complexity, and of course, entanglement entropy is not the geodesics or the minimal area surfaces of entanglement entropy are not able to enter into the black hole, interior of the black hole, but this quantity is yes, so it's interesting to compute these quantities in different settings. And the idea is that the Fisher information, of course, when you have a proposal to compute something in holography, you should have a proposal to compute something in the dual field theory, right? The proposals to compute the complexity in quantum field theory have a close resemblance to computing the Fisher information or the Fubini student metric in a tensor network such like SEMERA. And the results given by Chapman, Heller, Pastaski, and others in 2018 is that the Fisher information in Gaussian SEMERA matches leading order calculations in holographic complexity. So basically, the Fisher information metric in SEMERA has, at least the proposal is that has something to do or has something to say about the holographic complexity calculations, right? So, anyway, but this is, of course, these are calculations in a free Gaussian theory. But as I told you some minutes ago, the tenet of holography is a strong coupling and large chain. So we think that it's necessary to develop non-perturbative interacting versions of these tensor networks in order to see what are the connections in case there are connections, right? So this can be reduced to the topic of similar for interacting theories. Of course, is the topic of going beyond Gaussian entanglers. How can we introduce? Can we create similar circuits with non-Gaussian entanglers? Right, now, with operators included in the entangler operator that are able to explore the non-Gaussianities of an interacting field theory. Well, first of all, just before going into these details, I would like to say that in order to apply a variational method like tensor networks for the field theory, we should have something general ansatz in order to capture the relevant physics going beyond the Gaussian physics. But we are interested in having calculability, right? Because at the end we want to calculate things. We are not very skilled in computing non-Gaussian path integrals, so the ansatz should keep the calculability or the Gaussian as intact as possible. And then it would be nice also have to some way of control what are the how we integrate high Gaussian momentum modes into the low energy physics. Right? Well, these are generalities, for instance, put by Kovner. It's actually late. So the topic in non-Gaussian entanglers. So in order to transform Gaussian states into non-Gaussian states, at the end, following the idea of Simira, we are going to start for a very simple Gaussian state, and we want to construct a complicated non-Gaussian state representing the interacting field theory. So we must incorporate higher order operators. I have to say there is a perturbative solution given by Kolder and collaborators. I will comment on this in a journal club tomorrow. But the question is, how do we non-perturbatively build these unitarities? What is the problem? The problem is that at the end, we want to compute this kind of things, these objects, right, in which H is the Hamiltonian, because we want to compute the, for instance, what is the energy density of the Hamiltonian in the non-Gaussian state. This unitarity is the exponentiation of a higher order operator, higher order in higher than two. This thing is that making this using the Hadamard lemma is given in terms of a sequence of nested commutators of these operators K and B. And the thing is that at the moment you have if this is a quadratic operator, everything is in control. You can this expansion is finite, gives you a finite operator. But if you introduce here higher order operator, this expansion at each new term adds more complexity to the operator you are generating. So immediately you are creating are out of control and you lose the calculability of everything, right? So of course, you can do it perturbatively. You can truncate this thing, but we're interested in doing things non-perturbative thing, not doing perturbative tensor networks, right? So I'm going to put you an example of the idea you have used. Is the following. Imagine a quantum mechanical problem with 2 degrees of freedom, x and y. Imagine you consider this wave with this wave function, this non-Gaussian wave function, with s is a parameter that is not necessarily small, right? So I can create this state from this one by shifting the variable x by this nonlinear function, right? This nonlinear function of the other degrees of freedom. The question is, how can I do this thing in order to have, not all, how can I implement this in an efficient and usable way, this shifting? You can consider this unitarity, right? We can consider this unitarity of this is the function f and this is the derivative. By the Hadamard lemma, it's possible to show that the new transform variables, this is the shifting I wanted to create the non-Gaussian state. The other degrees of freedom are left untouched, and this is the way of the transformation of the canonical momentums, right? So yeah, the interesting thing is that this transformation preserves the canonical commutation relationships between the original of the original variables, and is called a nonlinear canonical transformation of one degree of freedom by a nonlinear polynomial function of the other degrees of freedom, right? So we can generate the non-Gaussian wave function in this way by applying this operation. Interestingly, the Jacobian of this transformation is equal to 1, so a normalization of the Gaussian is preserved, and the expectation values of a polynomial operator can be evaluated. Imagine that you create a complicated operator as a polynomial of these canonical variables. So by this property, immediately you are going to have it's important to say that the truncation of this expansion is at first order in S, right? By the properties of this unitarity. So you are going to have here a complicated polynomial depending on different values of S, but you end up doing a Gaussian expectation values. So these ideas have, were put into the in the context of interacting quantum field theories by Lutz Pauli, Will Ritchell, and Rodrigo Ibáñez-Meyer and others in the 90s. Now we are, for instance, in our last paper in collaboration with José Juan Fernández Melgarejo, published was accepted last week. We have used these non-canonical transformations in interacting quantum field theories to give a proposal to compute entanglement entropy. We have put also these ideas, this kind of ideas of nonlinear canonical transformations in the context of SEMERA, right? In the context of in collaboration with José Juan and with Emilio Torrente, University of Murcia. Well, what I'm going to say here is basically this is going to be this talk, and according to the time I left, is the coarse grain is going to be even higher, and this is the details that you can find in the paper, even in the journal club tomorrow. I will try to be more specific, but we have tried to build interacting similar circuits that we call very original ICMERA, and the idea is exactly to follow the prescriptions of the tensor network circuits, is that to this Hamiltonian evolution in a scale. Here we put the entangler for the quadratic part of entangler for the free theory, and then we add a non-quadratic operator, right? A non-quadratic non-Gaussian operator, and here's the dilatation. This is the Gaussian disentangler, and this is the non-Gaussian disentangler. Of course, here we have a quadratic operator. Here we have a non-quadratic operator. This is an example. This can be much more general. We can put here some phi to the m, p phi m, and there is the new variational parameter. So this Gaussian variational parameter, non-Gaussian variational parameter, and s that is a tracking parameter that must be optimized. Well, from the point of view of the from the point of view of the wave functionals, we create complicated wave functionals, and of course, what is happening to the fields, canonical fields? So I show you, but the Gaussian entangler creates a linear transformation of the fields, and now we keep this linear transformation, and then we have this nonlinear deformation of the momentum modes. Well, this is for the phi, for the pi, and of course are scale dependent. For the Gaussian MERA we have linear scale dependent field transformations. Now we have implemented nonlinear scale dependent field transformations. Well, this parameter h is there is a lot of notation. I don't want to confuse you, especially with so. There's not much time, but these variational parameters or these parameters are combinations of all of the variational parameters of the are mixings of the Gaussian parameters and the non-Gaussian parameters. But at the end, what we have is that still we have something to optimize, that we have a flavor of Gaussian or the Gaussian entangler, and something that we have to optimize that has the flavor of defining the non-Gaussian entanglement. Well, the thing is that this non-Gaussian variational parameter must fulfill some truncation constraints. So in order to have not the Hadamard lemma truncates at first order for the canonical field transformations, we have to impose something called truncation constraints, right? This is necessary in order to keep the truncation, to keep the mechanical transformation to be in a canonical transformation, to keep the commutation relationships. This immediately leads us to give ansatz for the structure of these variational functions, that for this case, for the variational parameters of the non-Gaussian entangler, this again is a scalar function. It's a scalar function that must be determined. We have these gamma functions, the momentum cutoffs, and then the novelty is that we have to introduce this gamma b, that is something like it's a momentum correlator. That must be optimized variationally. The basic idea of this object is that this is going to decide which regions of momentum space are relevant for the transformation. So basically, it's going to decide how or what higher order or high energy momentum modes are going to modify low momentum modes. This is basically the idea of this new function that we have introduced. And it is defined in terms of this gamma cutoff functions, and we introduce here two variational parameters that must be optimized in a concrete example. So I'm out of time. So if you let me you 5 minutes, I will, I think I will be able to finish. So now with this structure, is able to we are able to compute the connected pair of correlation functions, the two-point correlation function, the four-point correlation functions, basically are given in terms of some variational vertices that are a combination of these variational functions. Of course, are non-zero as far as S, that is the tracking parameter of the non-Gaussianity, is different from zero, right? So immediately our ansatz gives these things are different from zero. And we have optimized trying to see an example for this with the lambda phi 4 theory in one plus one dimensions. We need to evaluate the expectation value for the non-Gaussian state at or this energy density at whatever scale. And this in orange are this is the terms that you obtain with a Gaussian ansatz. And these are all the terms that you have new with the non-Gaussian ansatz, right? So you have more terms, you have more variational parameters, so you are able to give a better prediction of the energy density or capturing different physics from the Gaussian. Well, the procedure is to minimize this with phi c is the expectation value of the field, and I will give the details tomorrow in the journal club. But this is the solution for the Gaussian part, for the Gaussian variational parameter, in which everything is as the free theory, but mu now is a variational mass given by a gap equation, and now this is the result given for the structure of the function in the non-Gaussian part, right? Well, it is more or less complex. I will show you some results. These are the two-point correlation functions for different interactions of the theory. This is a very small interaction, this is mild interaction, and this is very strong interaction, and this is for a state close to the UV, and this is for a state description close to the IR. So here the state is basically Gaussian. We don't have taken into account the non-Gaussian contributions at different length scales, and here we're more close to the UV. And this is more interesting, is the results for the connected part of the four-point correlation functions. And this is that the two contributions that we have in our formulas for the four-point correlation functions. That immediately you see the structure of the non-Gaussianities, right? Well, these simulations were carried out in order to see what were the results for this thing. And yes, only an obvious question probably for a discussion is how do you trust your results, or what do you think that your results are sensible? Well, yes, unfortunately, the real world is real. One idea should be, part of the program should be something trying to benchmark with experiments, something like these experiments, nice experiments in Vienna by Schittmeyer, in which with clouds of cold atoms are able to basically have measures of four-point connected pair of correlation functions in a many-body system that basically is the Sine-Gordon model. In some regimes is the lambda phi 4 theory. And the other thing is more theoretical, is that is the perturbative analysis of our IC MERA circuit, right? So this is the structure of the two-point correlators or the four-point correlators for the lambda phi 4 theory and perturbation theory. And yes, very quickly, this is a similar circuit which is only Gaussian. Basically, at the perturbative level, is able to capture these cactus-like diagrams, right? Cactus-like diagrams or super daisy diagrams. And now, using our kind of entanglers, we have seen that the structure of our two-point correlation functions, connected part of four-point correlation functions, takes into account these Feynman diagrams. This is for another kind of transformation in our disentangler, the P phi cube, capturing even more physics. This is only to say that at the perturbative level, we are sure that we are capturing much more physics than the Gaussian ansatz. So, but this picture is only true for at the perturbative level. At the non-perturbative level, we only work showing the results that we show you. I show you before. And just in order to finish, What about the Fisher metric? We have been computing the Fisher metric in this non-Gaussian circuit, in the non-Gaussian circuits, and we have found that the density of these entanglers of the, this Fisher metric has a part that is the Gaussian part, and then we have these corrections given by the non-Gaussian parameters. I write this here like GU and GQ, the quantum, because we have results that hopefully we will able to report these results in not a very long time, is that when we have large n and a strong coupling, the behavior of this density of this entangler is very promising because the Gaussian parts behaves by a factor like by n, so it's multiplied by a factor of large number of fields, but these quantum corrections are suppressed respect to this one. So this is something like a hint of that when we are taking large n and a strong, even when the strong coupling by with a fixed off coupling, this thing is basically we recover the Gaussian part and the quantum fluctuations are suppressed, right? And of course, another thing which we are working now is that in the possibility of reconstructing this thing or related geometry from a direct entanglement entropy calculation in the IC-MERA circuit. In order to finish, yeah, something I mentioned is that some interesting forthcoming directions should be if we are able to address experimental data. This is a dream. We have a work in progress trying to apply the nonlinear canonical transformations to the superfluid mode in insulation transition in condensed matter systems in Bose-Hobart. That is something that can be simulated in a quantum simulator. And of course, we have developed the fermionic nonlinear transformations, but still waiting for the applying these ideas into a concrete model. And with respect to holography, we hope to have results on the very very soon behavior of the density or of disentanglers of the Fisher information metric when we are dealing with large n limit of an IC-MERA circuit, and of course the final point for us is to be able to build up or make some kind of bull reconstruction with a differential entanglement calculation in IC-MERA. So yeah, that's all. Thank you very much, and sorry for the last part, very, very, very speedy. Thank you.
Thank you, Javier, for this interesting talk. So we are open for questions now. There is actually a question in the chat. Mm-hmm. Yanis Tisiklakis, who says, where does dimension enter in the 5-4 model?
I didn't understand. Where
does the dimension enter in the 5-4 model? I guess maybe space-time dimension, I don't know.
Where the dimension?
Yeah.
But the dimension,
maybe if Yanis is around, he can ask the question.
Yes. I guess what he is trying to say, but
maybe he was referring to the fact of to whether this is generalizable to other dimensions rather than 1+1.
Yes, sure. Okay. So here is I've used a very condensed notation, but when I put here momentum integrals or momentum, this all of this is defined for any dimension, right? This is of course this is for any dimension, right? There is no problem in formulating this and doing the computations. The other thing is that we choose 1+1 not by because the one plus one model has no renormalization problems or something like that. So everything is under control and etc. We are not going to have problems with this because we are divergent quantities but under control. When you go to a higher dimension, you have to take into account the divergences of some quantities that you compute using this normal order things. But the dimension in this model is for whatever dimension you want. The other thing is that for the models you choose, probably different dimensionalities give you different problems. Okay. I don't know if this.
So Germán is also asking via the chat, but I think he can ask indirect, no? So Germán, why don't you ask in viva voce.
Okay, yeah. Well, viva voce. Yeah. What is the quantity of this optimization? I missed that point, Javi.
The quantity that you want to optimize or the
No, the optimization. I mean, optimization. I mean, usually one uses the ground state energy or these kind of things. But
yes. The thing is that you have here the density, the energy density of your theory, and then you have to compute the expectation value.
All right.
Using this non-Gaussian state, and what I told you is that. If you use a Gaussian ansatz, you are going to have these terms, right? This is what gives you a pure Gaussian ansatz. And these are all the terms that are related with the non-Gaussian ansatz. Of course, some quantities, for instance, chi5 and chi6 are related with four-point functions, the structure of four-point functions, and chi3 and chi4 are related with three-point functions, chi2 with two-point functions, right? That in the perturbative level, well, you can relate with this kind of Feynman diagrams, but this picture of Feynman diagrams is only valid at the perturbative level of this nonlinear transformation. At the moment in which you go to a strong coupling, this picture is lost, right? Uh-huh. And you have to believe that you are, of course, at the perturbative level, you are capturing much more physics than the Gaussian. And the quantity that you have to optimize, as of course, is the we try to follow the idea of tensor networks is the energy.
Okay. Okay, thanks. Well, tomorrow you will explain more details, right?
Yeah, sure.
Right, okay, good, thanks.
More questions?
When you talk about simulations, you mean you put the model on the lattice and then you let it evolve there? Or no, what do you mean by simulation?
I think I use simulation in simulation. This is only a computer. This is basically computing the correlation functions and doing in a computer doing the Fourier transforms and
showing the integrals. Okay.
Another use for the simulation is that we are trying to work with models that are able. Experimental people are able to put it into a quantum simulator, right? An optical lattice or something like that. But this is a completely different way. And of course, you say evolve. No, we have not making any approach to time evolving states, right? This is for quantities that are static quantities, static states.
More questions? I have one. So it wasn't totally clear to me because it was very fast at the end.
Yeah, so.
Do you use perturbation theory as a way of choosing the way you generalize the entangling operation beyond the Gaussian or not? Or is it just because you make an ansatz which you can calculate with, and you don't know if it captures, for example, all the physics to one loop order, or to two loop order, etc. Is there some notion of?
We did it in reverse. We did it to be honest. We did it in reverse. We applied the transformation, right? The most easy implementable transformation because this is highly systematic, but the calculations are high cumbersome. And then we realized that when we did the perturbative analysis is that, okay, when you do the perturbative analysis here, you have a sense what kind of Feynman diagrams are you capturing at the perturbative level. Of course, this is the P53 transformation. It's a transformation that if you are in a symmetric phase of the 5-4 theory, you are not going to move out of the symmetric phase. This transformation, in some sense, is able to move the state from the symmetric to the anti-symmetric phase. So you can choose it. This is the kind of things we are thinking now. In trying to think in a perturbative level, in order to choose or have a hint of what kind of transformation we want to use, right? But at the end of the day, The problem is that this picture is only valid at perturbative level. We are not sure at this moment about when you go to a strong coupling, the variational parameters of the non-Gaussian entangler change in something like a Schwinger-Dyson like equation with a coupling. It's very difficult to see what are exactly are, right? So we don't have a bridge to understand if this, what you see here is what you are, you have some bridge in understanding what you are going to have in the non-perturbative level at this moment,
Mm-hmm. Well, but there are models which are solvable in the Larchian limit. Vector models, for example.
Yeah.
In which you have a gap equation that you can identify at the leading order in Larchian, etc.
Exactly.
So you can try this kind of formalism adapted to the Schwinger picture.
Exactly. This is namely, this is the thing that we are doing now. The problem is that still we have to, we are writing the results and we have to think about this. But this is exactly the kind of model we are using now. We are using the ON scalar model because the technique we are using is very, can be generalized very easily to this model. At this moment, immediately we have the Larchian expansion. It is known, and then we can study the behavior of the variational parameters when you take Larchian and a strong coupling, the fixed tough coupling. Yeah, of course. I mean, this is only the presentation of the, as I said, this is the idea of that if you want to, or if we want to connect these tensor networks with holography, the first thing we have to do is to go to the tenet of holography. It is a strong coupling and Larchian. Because comparing computations for a free theory, are very inspiring, but. So this is the only representation of what we have done. But of course, our next steps are towards going to Larchian and strong coupling, right? And to be honest, it's very easy. At least for vector models, it's very easy to generalize this technique. For vector models, I don't know, for gauge fields or something like that.
Okay, are there more questions? Okay, so if not, we thank Javier again.
Thank you
very much, Javier, for this nice talk.
Thank you.
And we will have this recording maybe tomorrow in the YouTube channel of the AFT. So I will stop the recording now.